Honorable Minister will reply.
So just give me a minute, sir. Sir, let me thank all the honorable members who participated in this very important issue of the COVID-related stress which companies will face. And the way in which the government wants to ensure that the pandemic-affected companies don't suffer without any kind of protection being offered to them. 16 speakers have given their valuable inputs. I'll begin by mentioning, because it gives a very good start for the debate, while answering, I'd like to first of all start with Professor Manoj Jha's comment that he feels that the government doesn't probably take the wisdom across the aisle and that parampara should go away. I want to assure him there's no such parampara. And actually speaking, we are quite ready and have always been keen to hear the views come from all sides of the aisle, not just the ones with Shah directly opposite, but from the entire house. So, Professor Manoj Jha, and through you for the rest of the honorable members, I want to assure you that I personally sit and hear every comment, not as a favor, it's my duty. And I honestly do take the inputs seriously and try to respond to each one of them. So, I prelude, as a prelude to the entire debate today, what actually made us have to come with an ordinance? In June, on 5th of June, it was gazetted. What was the need for the ordinance? And also, of course, we repeatedly hear that this government comes up with several ordinances. That's purely because this government wants to make sure that it responds to the developing situation in the ground and then comes back to the House to make the ordinance into a bill, and at the time of discussing the bill to pass it to become an act, we do take the views which come across from all sides of the House. So ordinances per se, I understand the spirit with which honorable members voice their concern about why ordinances, why can't you come up with a bill. I fully appreciate that concern. But even otherwise, between session, if there is a need for an ordinance because the ground situation demands it, I would think a responsive government's duty it is to at least use the ordinance to show that we are there with the people of India. So to that extent, I'm sure this House will appreciate that as and when a government decides for an ordinance, it is because of that, and sooner they come, whenever the next session happens, we come back to have the ordinance either presented as a bill or to say we withdraw the ordinance and not any further. So the situation which was before us in March was clearly because of putting lives before livelihoods. The Prime Minister, when he announced the Janta curfew itself, clearly said, look, we do not know what this is going to mean, how long it's going to last, but I'm sure this is the first remedy that we have in our hand, at least a preventive remedy, that we ensure that everybody stays where they are and safe and save lives. And therefore, at that time, if for the sake of protecting lives, you remain in a lockdown situation, naturally, businesses will suffer, financial markets will suffer, and as a result, the economy will be affected. But given that background, did we sit and watch doing nothing? No. Clearly, we said the disruption which is going to be faced by the companies, will have to be taken cognizance of, and therefore, if at all because of COVID and because everybody is made to stay in their houses, it causes trouble for businesses, and then they are sent for insolvency professionals to resolve it, it would be impossible to find resolution professionals. It will be impossible to even resolve the problems, and therefore it was decided that it is better to suspend Section 7, 9 and 10 of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code so that we can prevent corporate persons which are experiencing distress on account of that unprecedented situation being pushed into insolvency proceedings. And therefore the ordinance was brought in. The suspension of 7, 9 and 10 was the only intention, and with that intention the ordinance was brought in. Now, of course, we have also inserted a new section 10A in the ordinance itself, which clearly was repeated by several members. I wish to highlight that point, that notwithstanding anything contained in section 7, 9 or 10, after, on or after 25th March 2020, for a period of 6 months or such further period, not exceeding 1 year from such date as may be notified in this behalf. So, no application shall ever be filed, is the other aspect that we are highlighting, because initiation of corporate insolvency for matters which occurred during the lockdown period, for matters which occurred during this suspension period, should not be picked up even after the period is over. So our intention was that this period, immunity which is being given with a suspension, should be intact, and therefore we have insisted on bringing that explanatory note. So, however, this does not mean that insolvency related proceedings cannot commence on those which were prior to 25th March. That has also been made very clear. So this is only for those which arise during the COVID period. So the amendment, broadly, the amendment of Section 66, again, is that no application shall be filed by a resolution professional under the subsection 2 in respect of such default against which initiation of corporate insolvency resolution process is suspended as per 10A. So these were the only features with which we had come up with the ordinance. So IBC is such a critical part of business now. It is important for us to understand from various different angles how IBC has performed. I'll not give every instance where or every kind of example which is relevant for saying that IBC is doing its job, and the intention of IBC, bringing the IBC itself, is being very well served. But one concrete example which is very relevant for our period from among the various things related to IBC is, I want to quote on the NPAs of scheduled commercial banks which have been recovered through various channels, and I have sourced all my information from RBI. I just want to highlight how IBC is actually serving the purpose of making sure resolutions are offered. And I repeat, although it's a insolvency and bankruptcy code, the way in which this code has functioned, it ensures that most of the resolutions are happening to make the company as a going concern only, rather than liquidated. Priority is to keep companies to be a going concern rather than liquidate them at the earliest. So one example I want to give as a comparative account. Sir, I'm just talking about 2018-19 as a provisional figures. Lok Adalat, sir, recovered 2,816 crores, which constitutes 5.3% of all those amounts which were involved, which came to the Lok Adalat. DRTs recovered 3.5%, which is total amount involved which came as a case referred, and total actually recovered. So total amount recovered versus the total amount which was involved, which came to the DRT, 3.5% is what has been recovered. Surface E, sir, 14.5% have been recovered. Amount is 41,876, as opposed to the total amount involved, 2,89,073 rupees. Whereas IBC, sir, has ensured 42.5% of recovery, in the sense amount recovered is 70,819, as opposed to 1,66,600, as amount involved which came to the IBC with the reference of the IBC, and therefore the recovery, I'm only using for NPAs which are in the scheduled commercial bank category. This whole figure that I'm giving you is pertaining to only one section. This is not an entire IBC report card. But from among the various things that the IBC does, if you take the example of NPAs which are in scheduled commercial bank, this is the rate of recovery. And this pertains to only 2018-19, which are provisional figures. So I repeat, Lok Adalats, the recovery 5.3%, DRT 3.5%, each under their own cases, meaning recovered against what came to them, recovered against what came to them, like that. So 5.3 Lok Adalats, 3.5 DRTs, 14.5 Surface E, 42.5 in IBC. So again, as a prelude, I just want to highlight about the NCLT. Section 7 relates to financial creditors, Section 9 relates to operational creditors, and Section 10 obviously is for corporate debtors. I just want to tell you, sir, the amounts again of disposed cases before admission to the NCLT. So the fact that the IBC, its very presence, is helping people to resolve the dispute much before it is even entering into the NCLT itself is a substantial number. So we should understand that the ecosystem which has been created because of IBC, companies are now making sure that they will ensure that they solve the problem even without having to go to the NCLT and then sit with the resolution. As a result, I'm just reading out three figures of number of disposed cases, cases which are completely disposed even before the admission into the NCLT, and I'm giving you the data as of 31st July 2020. Section 7 related, which is the financial creditor, 2,789 company cases had been resolved even before they got admitted into the NCLT. And this amount which got disposed in this resolution is 1,96,171 crores. If this is the amount which gets resolved even just before getting admitted, because they want to clear up and solve the problems. And this is about Section 7 related cases. Section 9 related, which is the operational creditor related cases, sir, even before admission, and I'm giving data of 31st July 2020, 11,581 cases have been disposed of even before admission, Section 9 cases, and in this the amount which got resolved is 1,63,927 crores. So these are not small numbers. These are not small numbers wherein all the parties concerned agree to a solution, and most often these are settled without much contradiction or mutual dissent, and therefore a solution is getting arrived at even before entering the NCLT. And finally, sir, Section 10, corporate debtors. 140 cases were disposed of before entering the NCLT. Again, data for 31st July 2020, 15,000 1,53,372 crores have been sorted out. So now I come to answering specific questions which honorable members have raised. I wouldn't take much of your time. I know I have to finish it before 11:30, but my duty to answer some of the relevant questions, sir, if you would permit me. Vivek Tankaji, who is a very eminent advocate, has raised questions saying, and he is also moving an amendment saying, sorry. No, no, that's fine. I'm answering. It's all right to answer? I'm responding to you. Thank you. Sir, not exceeding 1 year. Those words have really become a bone of contention. This removal, if at all I remove not exceeding 1 year, Gupta ji also raised that question. It would naturally and directly mean excessive delegation to the executive. I would rather, looking at the circumstances which we obtain at that time, come to the House and say, look, this is where we are. This, at the moment, the amendment to the code gives me a provision to only extend till 1 year, if at all, because it's coming to an end on 25th September this year. 24th itself, we have to make an announcement about what is going to happen. But even if I do, it means that by March it should be ending. Then to remove it now would mean that I can go on doing. From the executive, I can do anything. I can go on extending forever. I'd rather not. But I would rather come here and ask the House, in its wisdom, would you want to extend? So that restraint we've put on ourselves, whilst it's tempting to have the executive take the power. We are not doing that. So the next thing, sir. Why suspend Section 10 and not allow corporate debtors to initiate proceedings? So the reason for suspension is difficulty in finding resolution professionals, resolution applicants, irrespective of who initiates the proceedings, outcome will be the same, that is, liquidation of the company. The code actually balances, sir, the rights of debtors and creditors, and we can't allow only the debtors to initiate and deny the option to creditors. So largely, that in broad brush, that's the response I would like to give you on that. And then also this expression was used, is it a blanket ban which is being imposed? Is it a blanket ban which is being imposed? Not certainly, sir, it's not a blanket ban. We are confining it only to those defaults which may arise during the COVID period, but it does not affect the applications already filed before the adjudicating authority for initiation of CARP, and ongoing corporate resolutions can continue. Also, this very sounds sensational, and many members did take it up, of course, not to sensationalize it, but with a concern that have we released the promoters from liability against fraudulent transactions? Very pertinent question, sir. I just want to say the ordinance and now the bill does not provide any protection against frauds. It provides protection to directors in respect of liability under subsection 2, which deals with exercise of due diligence to minimize the potential loss to the creditors. Further, section 166 of the Companies Act 2013, Vivek ji, you might know this, which requires a director to discharge his duties with due and reasonable care, skill, and diligence remains intact. Thus, there is no protection from fraud. We are not at all protecting from fraud. So this question of protection forever. A company which was viable before the onset of the pandemic may earn normal profits from current operations and become viable again after the impact of the pandemic subsides. It would, however, take years to wipe off the deep stress that arose during COVID-19 period for some companies, and some others may have a better revival impact. Depending on the nature of the industry, specific strength of a company, one may recoup the loss in 1 year, one may take several years. If the company is pushed into insolvency, when it is recouping the loss itself, the objective of the ordinance is lost. And that is why we have designed it in this fashion. So again, due concern a lot of members have expressed, have MSME creditors lost an effective means to recover? This particular code, sir, the IBC code, is not a recovery law. The creditors do have all kinds of options for recovery. Saving lives of companies is far more important than enabling recovery of loans, which may exist, which may be utilized through various other options which prevail. We had the compulsion to save businesses, corporate debtors, and they need to be insulated.
Sir Smith ji, please.
Rather than enabling creditors to recover the loan for which they have several other options. So then Sri Narayan Das Gupta ji raised this question that there is no distinction between small borrowers and large borrowers. There is absolutely a distinction in that the increase of the threshold that has been given, the increase in the threshold default from 1 lakh to 1 crore for initiation of insolvency proceedings protects small borrowers. So IBC cannot be implemented for those companies which are below 1 crore. So small MSMEs are not going to be drawn into this, if that's a fear. So I think partly I've answered Dinesh Trivedi ji's concern, that there are several other avenues through which recoveries can be done. One can use statutory options, one can use supervised compromises, court-supervised compromises. One can even use the RBI's prudential framework. Arrangements which are available under Companies Act can also be used. So recoveries are possible even through very many other sources. Sir, Honorable Member K.K. Ragesh was very concerned about the huge haircuts. As I said, sir, it may be called Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, but the emphasis has been on keeping companies as going concern. And therefore, maximum intention has been to make sure that we keep companies running, and even after that, if the question remains, it is important to understand that haircut depends on the value available when the company gets into the insolvency proceeding. Depends on the value at which stage you're going for liquidation. Financial creditors are getting 45% of the amount due to them once you get into liquidation. And they are getting about 190% of the liquidation value. This is after rescuing the company. So largely, I think I've addressed concerns which many of the eminent members have raised. I will go back to talking about Professor Manoj Jha on one question. What about employment? Was a very relevant, legitimate question to ask. 258 companies were rescued. Roughly one-third of these were defunct companies. These have enhanced their employment potential. 965 companies proceeded for liquidation. Three-fourths of these were defunct. Three-fourths were defunct companies, which means no employment there. But loss of employment was minimum even after they were liquidated. Earlier, I spoke about 258 companies which were rescued, which means employment is back again with them. Companies which had to be liquidated in total, three-fourths of them who were defunct were also given liquidation solution, and therefore at least loss of employment was reduced. 258 companies, sir, had assets of 96,000 crores. 965 companies sent for liquidation had assets of 38,000 crores. So in value terms, the assets rescued is about 2.5 times of the assets which went to liquidation. So the last which I want to respond to is the question of personal guarantors. A lot of members did voice their concern about personal guarantors. The court, sir, actually envisages resolution for three categories of individuals, namely the personal guarantors to corporate debtors and so on. Partnership firms, proprietorship firms, a lot of people have raised the questions, and the individual. Each category gets a unique solution and needs are separated, and the separate dispensation addresses each one of them. Given that provisions of individual insolvency are likely to impact a large section of population, it was decided to commence provisions relating to the personal guarantors to corporate debtors, first be implemented at this stage, and to then use the learnings from this from there to other categories. The corporate debtor often has guarantors. So for comprehensive corporate insolvency resolution and liquidation, we felt it was necessary to that the insolvency of the corporate debtor as well as its guarantors are considered together to whatever extent it is possible. So I hope that explains the situation about the personal guarantors. So I think largely I've addressed the questions raised. There were other questions about MSME payments which are due and so on. I can always address that at a personal level with the Honorable MPs. With this, I thank you for giving me the opportunity to reply, but I seek the House's cooperation to pass this.
Thank you, Honorable Minister. Manne KK Rageshis.